Hello, this is Freethought Forum, a program by the Atheist Society of Knoxville and the Rationalists of East Tennessee. I'm Larry Rhodes.
And I'm Faithless Forrest. And we want you to know that if you don't believe in God, you're not alone. Right here in East Tennessee, you can find free-thinking atheists and agnostics. This is a show for them and people like them curious about living a life free of superstitious beliefs. And today our special guest is...
Hi, I'm Andy Kramer. I'm professor and head of anthropology at the University of Tennessee.
That would be a good person to have if you're talking about evolution on the show. This is a call-in show. However, we only have one phone line. If you can't get through, we invite you to email questions to us live on the show at freethoughtforum@yahoo.com. And it should be up on the screen, freethoughtforum@yahoo.com. The Atheist Society of Knoxville is a fun meetup group that often meets at a bar or eatery. We even sometimes do karaoke. Tonight's meetup will be at Barley's Tap Room and Pizzeria for happy hour for food, drink, and conversation. Also, on Friday nights, we usually meet at Agave Azul. Look for the silver-jacketed copy of The God Delusion standing upright on the table. And as Matt Dillahunty of The Atheist Experience always says, everyone is welcome to visit our happy hour for food, drink, and conversation. But if you plan to preach, proselytize, provoke, or punch, please don't.
Well, the monthly activities of the Rationalists of East Tennessee occur on the first and third Sunday mornings, and they're usually lectures or lively roundtable discussions. The second Sunday is book club. That's an afternoon activity. February's book is Predictably Irrational, The Hidden Forces That Shape Our Decisions. The fourth Sunday is a reflections gathering. It is an afternoon potluck get-together, usually at a member's home.
Visit our websites for additional monthly program details, including times and locations.
Today's show is about Darwin Day, and this year is focusing on the science of human evolution. But first, we have some topics in the news.
Well, in the news is Darwin Day.
All right.
Well, at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, there are events going on now through Friday.
All right, you can search online for Darwin Day Activities UTK, and that'll get you to the webpage that's behind us where there's a full calendar of events. I think this evening there's going to be a teacher's workshop, and the next two evenings have a couple of guest speakers that I believe have come in from out of town.
Faith, the last time we were on, we spoke about the upcoming transit of Venus. Time to talk about how to observe this last-in-our-lifetime event.
Okay, but let's review. If you go out in the evening just after sunset and look to the west, you'll see a bright white point of light. This is the planet Venus. Its orbit is closer to the Earth, to the Sun than the Earth, and so it is gradually overtaking the Earth.
This summer, the planet Venus will pass in front of the Sun June 5th and 6th. This is a rare event, and no adult alive now will see it again until 2017, so don't miss it. The best place to see this once-in-a-lifetime event, 2017.
It's over 100 years
from now. That's okay. The best place to see this once-in-a-lifetime event is in Alaska, Hawaii, or Tahiti.
I'd like to do the Tahiti thing myself. Yeah. So let's be clear. Do not look at the sun. Even with welding glasses, do not look at the sun. Welding glasses made for a different purpose, and some of them are just not good enough. You need a number 14 or darker, so if you don't know what you have, don't take chances. You can also buy special filters for telescopes or binoculars. Your sight is worth the expense.
You can also build a simple projection system or a pinhole camera. It's the simplest form is a long box. Punch a hole at the top, add some aluminum foil with a tiny hole in the sunward end and a white piece of paper on the inside where you can see the image. Note that the longer you make the pinhole camera, the bigger the image. Make the pinhole for a sharper image, small for a sharper image. But don't wait for June. Buy your filters now or build a pinhole camera now and start practicing it. You can watch clouds crossing the sun for practice, and you can watch for sunspots. On an evening in Saturday, on May 20th, you can watch the sun beginning a partial eclipse at sunset. That would be good practice.
All right. Well, So today we have a special guest. We've already heard your name. so Larry, let's introduce our guest.
Okay. Today we have with us Dr. Andrew Kramer, who's a professor of head of Department of Anthropology at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. He's a paleoanthropologist whose research focuses on reconstructing human evolution. His work has taken him around the world from Southeast Asia to Africa, from Europe to Middle East. Thanks for being with us today.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm happy to be here.
Well, Dr. Kramer, we're talking about Darwin Day and evolution, and I know that some of our viewers are probably not likely to have a proper understanding of the ideas and issues surrounding evolution. Can you help start us out? Larry and I will ask questions which we know from experience some viewers might ask, and we ask viewers to please call in and help us ask questions.
I'd be happy to.
Evolution is a fact?
That's an interesting question.
Theory, yeah.
It actually is. It is a theory that is supported by a multitude of facts, and it's important, I think, to demonstrate the meaning of theory in the scientific context. In the lay context, often theory is thought of as being synonymous with a hunch or a guess, as in a cop show, and they say that our theory is that the butler did it. Mm-hmm. But in science, that is a very different meaning. In science, theory means explanation. Mm. And evolution today is, and in fact since 1859, has been the best explanation science has formulated in explaining the diversity of life on this planet.
Since 1859, the details of how it happened have come about, have changed, but the theory itself is rock solid ever since that time it came into conception.
That's true. I mean, there are a number of enhancements, there are a number of debates within the within evolutionary biology and the other evolutionary sciences, but Darwin's synthesis of, as we'll discuss in a few moments, his major points of descent with modification, as well as the major mechanism of natural selection, still are as well accepted today as they were when they were proposed back over 100 years ago.
Okay, so Darwin, you know, wasn't the first to talk about evolution. Evolution was on the lips of other scientists at that time, but Darwin was fortunate enough to come of age at a time when he had, how should I say, a young, adaptable mind. He went on a trip around the world exploring things, as well as with him he had brought a copy of a famous book by, I think it's
Lyle
is his name, it's pronounced?
Lyle.
That was talking about the evidence for a deep age of the Earth.
Right, it was Principles of Geology, and in that book, Lyle developed the idea, though he didn't formulate it himself. It was actually from a predecessor named Hutton, of uniformitarianism. In other words, that the present is the key to the past.
So if he hadn't carried that book with him, he probably would have been trying to develop his theory in a 6,000-year-old time period.
Well, it's interesting because I think the genius of Darwin was not that he was the first to come up with ideas, but instead he was an amazing synthesizer of information that was present and an integrator of information into new ideas that hadn't been thought of before.
Right. People don't realize that humans have been modifying species for millennia. Making better cows, better, more huntable dogs, per se, pigeons that would perform in certain ways and look in certain way. But that was all human modification. What he did was he figured out that nature had a way to do it itself.
Exactly. That's exactly what he did. In fact, he used a lot of the data from domesticates, pigeons and so on, in being able to extrapolate to the wild world and understanding that what was happening in the farmhouse and in the kennel and elsewhere was also happening in the woods, in the jungles, right, in the plains, and that was really his amazing contribution, his ability to integrate and synthesize mm-hmm. these things.
And, yeah. And a lot of times in earlier history of man domesticating animals, they didn't even realize that they were changing them, but they were picking out the ones that produced more milk or the ones that protected the flock better, and then breeding those, not really knowing that they were creating future generations right. would have those traits.
And Darwin's idea came directly from that, as far as what it was initially called as artificial selection, and he changed it and extrapolated, mm-hmm. expanded it into natural selection.
So is it fair to say that we can say that the assertion that many opponents of evolution make, that humans have never seen a species come into existence, is wrong? Because in a sense, domestication is that. There's certainly going to be animals that are now domesticated that just don't stand a chance of living and reproducing on their own.
Well, I think that could be a valid criticism of that argument from the anti-evolutionists. However, though, what they're really talking about is that we've never seen a dog turning into a cat or anything like that.
Which, of course,
that, of course, is a legitimate complaint in that, of course, we're not going to see those kinds of what are referred to as macro evolutionary changes, in which these major speciations are occurring, in which you actually see the transformation of one form into another.
Well, let's talk about that
you need a lot more time, and that's, of course, what the fossil record
documents. Let's talk about cat and dog transformations in a moment. We have our first call. Larry, why don't you greet the caller?
Welcome to Freethought Forum. I have a name or a nickname. You're on. Please listen to the phone and pay attention to the phone only, please.
Caller, are you hearing us at all?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're on. May we have a name or a nickname?
My question is that can animals just adapt to nature?
Caller, we think we heard your question, but can you give us a name or a nickname so that we know how to address you?
Yeah, this is Joe.
Hello, Joe. And your question was, can animals adapt to nature?
Yeah, you were talking about how he went and seen how the animals just kind of adapt to nature and farmland, mm-hmm. and as well as in the jungles. And I just wanted to see if they just naturally do that.
Dr. Kramer?
Certainly. Animals do adapt. Those that don't die, those that do well, survive, live long, pass on those traits that allow them to adapt to their offspring. And that in fact propagates those good traits down through the generations. And that's how Darwin discussed how adaptation occurs and eventually how new species can form, given the accumulation of these new traits that are passed on from generation to generation over the millennia.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, before you go, can we ask, have you watched our program before?
This is the first time, and when I started to watch it, I was very interested.
All right.
Cool. Well, we're here every Tuesday.
Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, during your explanation to me, you mentioned how nature selects for the changes, and I guess I was biting my tongue not to interrupt and say something that I think always needs to be emphasized, and that is that the changes that occur from one generation to another tend to be random. They're not directed. And that what nature is doing is that it's picking, or it allows to breed to the next generation selectively somewhat more variations that just happen to be beneficial.
Correct.
All right. And so there's no intent to adapt to the changing environment on the behalf of these creatures.
We have to emphasize this. Some people have a misunderstanding that individual generations can adapt. And we're not talking about individual organisms or individual generations. It happens over a long period of time that certain modifications or mutations will be selected for by the environment and will eliminate those that are not suited for that environment, and therefore over a long period of time the species itself will change.
Okay. Well, right before the caller came, you talked about how critics of evolution say that, well, we never see a cat giving birth to a dog, for instance. Now, is that a fair representation of the assertions of evolution?
No, but in fact, the main critique of evolution has to focus on us. And most people say that we'll never see an ape turn into a human. And for that matter, if we didn't, in fact, come from apes, why are there still apes? So that's often a claim that's been made by people that might not understand evolution as well.
We've heard it here on the show, too.
And something that I certainly can address in the context of our discussion this afternoon.
All right. Well, I think the slide that we got over our head echoes that very question.
Okay, I think it does. And so this slide illustrates the two main points that Darwin made in his landmark volume, The Origin of Species, in 1859. As an aside, though, a lot of people think of it as The Origin of the Species, with a definite article referring to us, but in fact, it was The Origin of Species, and he said nothing about humans in that book. Only at the very second to last page did he mention, "And light will be shed on our origins."
Right. He really was afraid to go there.
Exactly. But of course, everybody made the leap. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until 1871 with his Descent of Man that he actually addressed human evolution. Mm-hmm. But in his book, in The Origin, two main issues were raised. Two main points were discussed. And in fact, natural selection, which is what most people think, really only took the final four chapters of the book. The first 10 were on descent with modification. And as you can see, that evolutionary tree behind us illustrates the point here in which the discussion of apes turning into humans is addressed. And if we look at that, you can see that there's three modern species listed. There's species A, B, and C. But the significant aspect in the context of reacting to this claim that if we came from apes, why they're still apes, is that we came from a common ancestor that we share with living apes. In particular, most recently, the common ancestor we share with chimpanzees. And this common ancestor, to the best of our ability to determine through genetics and through the fossil record, probably lived between 5 and 8 million years ago. And since then, chimps have been evolving in their own lineage, and our ancestors have been evolving in our own lineage since we last shared that common ancestry. And so when we say that apes evolved into humans, we're not saying that modern apes evolved into modern humans. What we're saying is that we both share common ancestry, very similar to how cousins share mm-hmm. grandparents.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we wouldn't say that humans evolved from chimpanzees.
Absolutely not.
And it would be wrong to say that chimpanzees evolved from humans. We have a common great-great-great-grandparent of some sort.
Exactly.
How many generations might that be?
I just go with millions of years. I'm not going to try to break that down into generations.
Well, right. Another thing is, though, there may still be apes and chimpanzees because they grew up in an environment that didn't change, like exactly. the environment that we migrated into changed.
Exactly. Yeah. And then if we try to reconstruct that common ancestor, that is very relevant to that question because the
environment changes the organism.
Exactly. And if we look back, that common ancestral condition was probably very similar to what we see in modern apes and very different from what we see in us. So that common ancestor would have reminded us of an ape, and it would not have reminded us of a modern human. We have changed much more since we split from that common ancestor that we share with chimps than chimpanzees have. Not to say that chimpanzees haven't changed, but we have changed much more.
I know it was, I think it's within the last year, I'd heard about the discovery in, I guess, Western Africa of stone tools that it's thought that chimpanzees used, not actually real deep in time, but probably, I think, potentially before contact with modern humans.
Hmm. And that's very likely, in fact. And what's interesting as well is that these stone tools are often used to crack these very difficult to crack nuts called mangango nuts.
Mm-hmm.
And they're found both in East and South East and in West Africa. But what's very cool, and which illustrates perhaps, I think, culture in non-human primates, is that the Western African chimpanzees, particularly from the Thai forest and the Ivory Coast, have learned to use these stones to crack open these nuts.
Mm-hmm.
While the same stone, the same nuts, are present in East Africa at the sites of Gombe, which was, of course, first made famous by the work of Jane Goodall, but those chimps there have never learned how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the ability to pass on this cultural knowledge, this learned behavior from generation to generation is presently happening and probably goes pretty deep back in time in West Africa, but somehow the East African chimps never learned how to do it.
Well, it made me want to actually ask several kinds of questions. One is that, in a sense, what we could be saying is that West African chimps are in the Stone Age and East African chimps are not, or perhaps lost it.
Well, we have no way of determining whether or not they lost it or not. We don't really have much of an archaeological record that we can ascribe to chimps.
But stone tools might yet be found since they, unlike organic remains, they're
true,
durable.
But they're going to be so primitive as well, they might be difficult to distinguish between early hominid
stone tools.
And that could make it problematic for our archaeologists in determining who made what back in the Stone Age.
Speaking of primitive humans, some of our viewers may not be familiar with Lucy or Ardipithecus. Would you like to talk a little bit about what that means in
sure.
this context?
Sure, I'd be happy to. The human fossil record, despite what some naysayers claim, is really one of the more complete large mammal fossil records that we have. The demonstration of the evolution of whales from a terrestrial ancestor, as well as some other large-bodied mammals, some antelopes, for example, horses have very good fossil records, but so do we. We have a wonderfully complete and diverse fossil record. And so this fossil record tells us very much about how our evolution progressed over time from that common ancestor that we share with chimpanzees up until the present day. And the two species that you just mentioned are representatives of some of our earliest ancestors, very, very soon after that split between the common ancestors that we share with the chimpanzee and ours started to diverge. And the first of these, which is listed for you and shown above on the screen, is very recently been published. This is Ardipithecus ramidus, which is one of our earliest potential ancestors, dating to 4.4 million years ago from the site of Eremus in the middle Awash region of Ethiopia.
And how do we know it's just not a skeleton of a monkey or an ape?
Well, you know what? I'll be honest with you. And even though I'm on television here, I'll still be honest with you in the context of my perception of this. I am not convinced that this is, in fact, on the hominin line already. I think it may be...
Well, there were four or five different hominid species at the time.
True, but this is one of the more complete, we're one of the best represented as far as number of fossils now. Mm-hmm. It was just announced, in fact, it was first discovered in 92, announced in 94, but it took over 15 years for it to be fully published, and it was published in a very important issue of the journal Science in October of 2009. And in that, the authors claim that this is very close to that divergence from the common ancestor we share with apes. And they claim that this is an early hominid already on our line. And the reason they claim this is that they reconstructed it to have been a biped on the ground. And being a biped, in other words, walking upright on two legs, is the hallmark feature of being a human and a human ancestor. Mm-hmm. Bipedality, the ability to walk upright, preceded all the other traits that we now think of ourselves as being human. It precedes language, it precedes tool use, it precedes culture, it precedes civilization and all of those things.
How can you tell that it walked upright just by looking at its skeleton?
Well, that's a very good question. And in fact, there's some very significant bony correlates of being upright that are very easily distinguished from those that you see in an animal that is four-legged. And we'll talk about that in particular when we talk about the next human species that we want to talk about, and that's Lucy and Australopithecus afarensis. But one thing that I did want to say before we moved on from Ardipithecus was that if you look on the picture of the feet on the right.
Over Larry's head.
Okay. And that is troubling for a lot of us in the field, because if you notice, those feet look like hands.
Mm-hmm.
And
progressing,
one of the
climbing.
Exactly. One of the things that really is distinctive about humans and our ancestors is that we've lost that splayed off big toe that we could grasp with in our ancestral condition that monkeys and apes still use. In fact, we're the only primate species that does not have a grasping big toe anymore. However, Ardipithecus still had it. And that, to me, is one of the major reasons why I'm still somewhat skeptical about being at a full biped and perhaps even already being on the human line.
Did he have the upright pelvis?
Well, that's another thing. The pelvis, as well as the rest of the skeleton, was so badly crushed and damaged through the preservation process that the reconstructions, though they've been reconstructed to be more human-like, again, I don't have as much confidence as perhaps I would if these fossils were as complete and preserved as well as many other fossils have been.
So
in fact, the pelvis has been reconstructed by one of the top experts in the field to indicate that the higher part of the pelvis was more human-like, the lower part of the pelvis was more ape-like. And from that, he concludes that it was upright.
Now, wouldn't this actually be the case if evolution is true, that we will find fossils that we absolutely can't assign? And that's the whole point, is that things blur.
Well, that's a very good point, Faithless, and I think as you go farther back in time, along those evolutionary lineages back towards the common ancestor, mm-hmm. you're going to be sampling
more
species and populations that are going to be more and more similar to one another on either side of those lines, and eventually they will blur. And so Ardipithecus may be a very good example of that.
You used the word line, and it made me want to comment on the only drawing that was in Origin of Species is a line drawing Darwin made, similar to the drawing we had previously. Could we back up a couple of drawings to that drawing that showed the branching patterns? So those kind of represent this sort of idealized family trees. But there's a thing that the viewers should remember, in that those lines aren't thin. Those lines have a width themselves. Over all of time, there's a fuzziness to them because the population has some diversity. And certainly by the time those lines get down to where their distance is less than their width, it becomes kind of meaningless to talk about, is this a different species?
Absolutely.
Or not.
Very good point. Yeah, I think that's a very good mechanism to think of it that way.
All right. So we've spoken about Ardipithecus, and who do we speak about next?
Auntie
who do we
Lucy.
Meet next?
All right. So Lucy, right here, as we can see the pictures of the reconstructed skulls above and the reconstructed pelvis below. Pelvis is plural for pelvis. You notice that the skulls are not that different from one another. And in fact, Lucy and her species, which is known as Australopithecus afarensis, which means southern ape from the Afar, and that's the region in Ethiopia in which she was discovered, she dates to 3.2 million years ago, a good million, couple hundred thousand years younger than Ardipithecus. But Lucy and her species is probably, as far as I'm concerned, the best representative of a absolutely indisputable hominid that has already split from that common ancestor and is on the way towards us. And the reason for this is that even though if you look at superficially, those skulls and faces look very similar, the chimpanzee in between Faithless and myself and the hominid in between Larry and myself, the skulls aren't that different. In fact, Lucy's species, afarensis, from the neck up, still was very ape-like. Mm-hmm. But the significance here, and one of the things that I think really demonstrates how wonderfully the human fossil record shows just what Faithless was referring to before, is how it gets fuzzy and more difficult to distinguish as you go farther back in time, is that below the neck, she was very much, and her species was very much like us. In particular, the pelvis, as you can see, the very short and broad pelvis versus the very tall and thin pelvis, is a real key character that distinguishes a biped, an upright walker, from a quadruped. And so all the evidence from her hips, her legs, her feet, all indicate that Lucy and her species, Australopithecus afarensis, were walking on two legs.
So this goes very much forward to the theory that we were walking upright long before we started getting increased brain capacity.
Exactly, exactly. And in fact, her body, as you can see, is very short. That's Lucy compared to a modern human. And she was perhaps 3.5 feet tall, tiny, but she walked upright. Her skull was in the ape range as far as brain capacity, a full third the size of ours, in so many respects, very, very primitive. No evidence of language, no evidence of stone tool use. All of that came later. What came first, and what probably led us on our rather unique evolutionary trajectory, was getting up on those hind legs.
Okay. Well, let's remind the viewers that this is a call-in show, and today's topic is going to be human evolution, and we have an evolutionary biologist. So if you've always wanted to ask an evolutionary biologist tough questions, this is your chance. The phone number is there on the screen, I guess down in front of me, and give us a call now. All right. I wanted to encourage people to call, but there was something great that you guys were just discussing, and I've lost it. So you guys are going to have to pick up a conversation for a moment while I get reconnected.
Well, there was one thing that I was going to ask, but I think it's a little off topic. I understand that there's a whole lot more biodiversity in genetics and stuff in a small band of chimpanzees than the entire human race, that the humanity passed through a bottleneck of some kind in the past where the total number of living humans on the world was like 10,000 or something.
That is an hypothesis.
So it's not a theory yet.
Well, I think it has yet to be demonstrated to the satisfaction of the entire field. There may have been some genetic bottlenecks in human evolution. I'm not certain whether or not we ever got down to such a number, okay, as far as only 10,000.
Well, you would say that there's a huge amount of diversity genetically in chimpanzees over the amount of diversity in humans.
Well, I think that there is certainly that's been shown in mitochondrial DNA. But as far as worldwide genetic diversity, I think the reason that it seems like that, I think, with chimps is that it's been partitioned geographically from the West, the Central, and the East African chimps. So they don't have any contact anymore. Certainly the West and the East African chimps don't. One of the reasons that we have seemingly a genetic melting pot among humans is our ability and the likelihood that we're traveling, interbreeding. Mm. You can literally find your mate from the other side of the world at this point.
And it's been going on for quite a while
now. It has been.
I have a picture of Lucy standing upright as an artist would reconstruct her. I thought that would be enlightening.
Yeah, I think that's a wonderful artist reconstruction, a relatively recent one that was done by Jay Maternus, a really terrific illustrator. And I really enjoy this little slice of life there, because if you look at it, there's a number of things that are striking. First, you can see how those individuals cannot be matched by anything alive on the planet today. There's nothing that looks like that on the planet today. Now, if you just looked at the head up, well, it might look ape-like. Mm-hmm. Look at the head down, neck down, you might be saying, well, that might just be a big, hairy human. But this is what we see from afarensis. And afarensis was literally a unique species, something that we cannot analogize to anything living on the planet today. But what it illustrates, I think beautifully, is this pattern of evolution in which we see different things evolve at different rates, and how as we go back in time, we start to see things that are not easily pigeonholed into either ape or human categories, as the anti-evolutionists must place all the fossils, or else they'd have to accept the reality of transition. And that's, of course, what we're talking about.
And that's exactly the word I was going to say. This is the transitional, an example of features that are transitional,
exactly,
undeniable. There will be other features that are transitional
as
well.
It's deniable, but it is. But,
all right.
But I think science is
not rationally deniable.
The parsimonious explanation is explaining it as a transitional form.
All right. Exactly. Down to that, isn't it?
Exactly.
And this slide also mentions something that I was going to. I remember what I was going to say before I interrupted myself with to ask callers, and that was, you mentioned how short Lucy was, but Lucy was female,
exactly,
and it appears that the males are much larger.
Very good point. If you notice this, you'll see that the female is quite a bit shorter than the male, mm-hmm, and this is, of course, characteristic of many primate species. This is known as sexual dimorphism, in which males, mm-hmm, are often, in some primate species, twice the size of females. In gorillas and orangutans, baboons, we see that quite often, mm-hmm, and it might have been close like that as well in afarensis. Which indicates a lot of male-male competition for mating. Mm-hmm. And so another really interesting thing that I'd like to point out in this artist reconstruction is that if you look in the background, they're not restricted to the ground. In fact, Australopithecus afarensis, even though it did not have a grasping big toe like Ardipithecus still did, it had lost that grasping big toe, still was more adept in trees than any of us probably ever will be. And they had very, very powerful and relatively longer arms to allow them to do this, and curved, powerful fingers with powerful muscles for flexion to be able to grasp and hold, mm-hmm, to be able to do that. So they were probably very forelimb dominated, using their arms to climb. And they probably needed to, because they were still small, even though the female was 3.5 feet, the male maybe 5 feet tall. They didn't have the big canines, they didn't have any weaponry, and so it was likely that they still needed to use the trees as refuges to sleep in, perhaps to feed in, to escape from predators. So I think it's a wonderful example, once again, of how they're not quite human yet, but they're sort of on the way.
Interesting that you, excuse me, mentioned that they didn't have large canines. That seems to go against the assertion that perhaps there was male-to-male competition for mating.
In fact, that's a good point. One of the researchers, in fact, the researcher who's emphasizing the bipedality of Ardipithecus, suggests that they were, in fact, pair-bonded because of the small canines, mm-hmm, and that males provisioned females, and that's what led to the pair-bonding and so on. Many of the unique characteristics of humans, such as the loss of estrus, the loss of obvious estrus in females. And this would be as a result to allow females to maintain a monogamous, a pair-bonded relationship with a male who would provision her and her offspring. And this is what allowed humans to be able to expand around the world, according to this researcher's opinion, researcher's idea.
So this is 3.5 million years ago or so? 4 million?
Between 3 and 4 is when afarensis existed.
Okay. And so which would the next step be? What were you going to say?
And I was going to say, and once again, no evidence of tool use for this species, right?
Likely that they were using tools at least as well as modern chimpanzees could. Mm-hmm. But we don't have any evidence of stone tool use in manufacture until 2.5 million years ago.
And I guess the manufacturers, that may be a critical thing, that chimpanzees, I don't know that they shape tools.
They don't shape stone. They use them.
They find them.
And they naturally fracture them as a result, but they don't shape them.
Yeah. So that will be our next species we want to talk about.
We could.
All right.
We could.
Yeah, let's move on. Encourage callers. I think we've had a couple of callers, but maybe they weren't quite brave enough to speak to us on air. Please give us a call. Ask an evolutionary biologist today. All right.
So Homo habilis.
Homo habilis.
Habilis.
That's right. Now notice this is not Australopithecus anymore. And now we are referring to perhaps one of the very first species that represents our own genus. We are Homo sapiens, and it was named by Linnaeus back in 1758. Wise man, Homo sapiens, really man wise, move the modifier around. But Homo habilis was named by the very famous Louis Leakey and his colleagues John Napier and Philip Tobias in 1964 from fossils that were discovered at Olduvai Gorge in East Africa. And Homo habilis was presumed to have been the maker of the stone tools, the Olduvai stone tools, the most primitive of these stone tools, found at Olduvai Gorge as early as the 1930s by Louis Leakey, and then subsequently by he and his wife, and their researchers at Olduvai Gorge. And so Homo habilis, which means handy man or man handy, is the species that presumably was the tool maker at Olduvai.
Okay, but they would make the primitive tools, but they wouldn't really improvise on them or improve them.
They were like flaking and making sharp cutting edges,
right? And that's exactly what they were doing. The very first stone tools were very, very primitive and unsophisticated implements that were basically river cobbles with a couple of pieces knocked off of them to make a sharp edge.
Well, great. We've been motioned that there's a caller here. I'll grab it. Yeah. Hello, welcome to Freethought Forum. Please give us a name or a nickname, and please listen to us on your telephone, not the television. Hello, caller, are you hearing us?
Yes, I am.
All right, please give us a name or a nickname so that we know how to address you.
Terry.
Terry. Great, thanks for calling. Do you have a question or a comment for us today?
Maybe you've covered this, but I just tuned in here. But it's always a question that I have about evolution, and it was, if we did evolve from primates, why are there still primates?
Well, thanks for asking that question. Andrew, jump on that, please.
Well, as we discussed earlier, primates, for example, apes, and we have come from ancient apes, but not the living ones. And as we discussed earlier, we share common ancestry with living chimpanzees, gorillas, and other primates. And what that means is that as you go farther back in time, we converge to a common ancestor. And the common ancestor that we probably share most recently with any primate is one that we share with chimpanzees. And that common ancestor probably lived in Africa between 5 and 8 million years ago. And so chimpanzees have evolved since that split, so have we. So we don't evolve from any modern living animals. We don't evolve from any modern apes or modern monkeys, but instead we share common ancestry. And so that is where we come from. And to say that we have evolved from any living ape or monkey is mischaracterizing the process.
You might also mention about the varying environments that we have moved into and left the old apes behind.
And that's true, and that's why we look so much more differently than chimpanzees probably do from that common ancestors, because we've invaded so many more new environments and adapted so many new ways and changed so much more since that common ancestry that we have become very much different from that common ancestor as well as the chimp.
You have to remember that the environment changes the organism, so that the ones who stayed in the jungle pretty much stayed adapted to the jungle. the ones who moved into Sahara Desert and north into Europe and across into Asia, they took on characteristics or evolved characteristics that would help them to survive in that environment.
I might almost assert it's a little bit different, that only those who evolved different characteristics could penetrate those new environments.
There you go.
They get selected by the environment.
Mm-hmm.
Terry, did we answer your question?
Well, yes, to a point. And I was wondering, is there any other evidence of evolution that may parallel that type of split or that type of common ancestry, that there might still be an old ancestry existing, which is quite different than what an evolved, and I'm not talking about person, but even in the animal kingdom?
Well, there's a number of them. If you look at animals that are close related to one another, there's often going to be fossil records that demonstrate that divergence from that common ancestry. And so really the fossils are the ones that provide for us the hard evidence, the direct evidence of that evolutionary trajectory, of those evolutionary changes since those animals last shared common ancestry. And so one of the better examples, for example, is the evolution of whales. Whales, we have an amazing fossil record that demonstrates whales that had vestigial limbs and whales that had limbs that were reduced but not vestigial, and whales that in fact weren't whales at all but were marine amphibious types of mammals, not unlike hippos and as well. So these are the kinds of animals that we have in the fossil record that demonstrate these kinds of transitions into animals that look today very, very differently from what their ancestors may have looked like.
And even if we didn't have the fossil record, we still have the DNA and RNA records. And it's been told to me before that we could take all the fossil records and throw them away almost now, because we've got the RNA and the DNA that would pretty much draw the same lines, the same evolutionary lines for us.
Often they do, but sometimes they tell conflicting tales. And I think
sure
it's the information. I'm a fossil guy, so I would hope you don't throw the fossil.
All right.
I understand that all this, you know, as much of proof as is, a lot of it is conjecture, but I can understand the line of reasoning. My one question is that there's a lot of discussion about physical evolution, but how about the mental evolution? What caused these people to leave that area, and what caused some apes to stay in their environment and others to evolve and move out of their environment so that they could have been changed? What mental process? Could it have been the diet or something like that?
That's an excellent question. And I think the evidence best supports, as far as the time frame that we're talking about, between 5 and 10 million years ago, there was a very major, in fact global, cooling and drying event that was happening throughout the world at this time, at the end of what's called the Miocene epoch of the Cenozoic era. And this resulted in the loss of habitat, in particular what apes are adapted to, and that's tropical forests, and the expansion of the grasslands, in other words, the savannas.
India running into the Asian continent.
True, and that was happening as well at that time. And the significance of this with respect to our evolution is that it's likely that our ancestors, instead of trying to stay in the trees and staying in the forests as many other apes were doing, but of course going extinct because of the loss of that habitat, our ancestors likely started to try to exploit the grasslands and the what's referred to as the forest fringe, so the area in between the grasslands and the forests. And this was a challenging new environment. And eventually, we were able to overcome those challenges and be able to spread around the world. Now, of course, it's a very simplistic explanation, but the evidence from our biology, from our anatomy, indicates that we were a more open, adapted creature, unlike other apes, and that may have led us on that path towards what we are today.
All right, great.
Okay, thank you so much for your input on that.
Thank you.
Before you go, Terry, have you watched previously?
Oh, from time to time.
Okay, well, thank you. Are you local to East Tennessee?
Yeah, actually, I'm a pastor out here in Cosby.
Oh, cool.
Okay, well, thank you for watching our show, and thank you for calling today.
Okay, God bless you. Bye.
All right. Well, we still have about 15 minutes of the program. We encourage viewers who are watching, please call in and ask an evolutionary biologist questions that you've been dying to ask. That will help me so I won't have to keep trying to think of questions. I couldn't help, though, but think, as you mentioned, the time frame for the cooling at the Miocene, and you described that as 5 to 10 million years ago. that 10 million years ago, South America was not connected by a land bridge to North America. And ocean circulation was very different, and the world was a warmer place. It is approximately, I think, something like 5 million years ago when the Isthmus of Panama rose. Maybe it's about 2 million years ago the isthmus closed, and there was then a lot of extinction that occurred in South America.
True.
Our evolution of human ancestors is set on this stage that was affecting, you know, all kinds of animals the world over.
Mm-hmm. Very true, and we are interconnected. And even more generally, I think it's a wonderful thing to acknowledge and to realize that humans are just part of this planet. Mm-hmm. And I think it's part of our responsibility to make sure that we understand that we share this planet, and we hopefully we'll maintain it for future generations, not of only humans, but of the rest of the life.
Of all the animals, we're the ones who can actually do something about it.
And unfortunately, we're the ones that can cause the extinction. So I think we have a large responsibility in that regard.
Well, as being handy humans still, we have tools that can let us do lots of things.
Yeah, good or bad.
All right, there was another slide here. Can we advance to that, maybe before the next caller's passed in? All right. So, tell us about Homo erectus or Homo ergaster. Why are there two? Why did I find two names Wikipedia?
All right. Well, Homo erectus, in fact, is what I did. My main gig. My dissertation was on Homo erectus from Java. I've done field work in Java, Indonesia. And I've written mostly on Homo erectus in my scientific writing.
All right. Well, maybe
so
the caller will want to talk about it, but we do have a caller, so
sure.
let's grab them. And Larry, you?
Sure. Welcome to Freethought Forum. May we have a name or nickname, please?
Yeah, this is Daniel.
Daniel, welcome. Did you have a comment or question?
Yeah, I had a question. I understand how microevolution seems to me to be a logical thing to believe. As far as small changes through things being left out of DNA, information being taken out. But is the theory of macroevolution, does that represent small changes of mutations that happen to benefit a species that would cause it to transition into a new species?
The idea of
mutations. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Sure, mutation is the source material for all evolutionary novelty. So without mutation, there would never be anything genetically new under the sun. And so even though mutation is a very rare event in our human perspective, given the fact that the Earth has been around here for 4.5 billion years, and life has been on the planet for over 3 billion years, probably 3.5 billion, the infrequency of mutation does not preclude its ability to provide raw material and new genetic combinations that new species actually can, that populations within species can incorporate into this kind of transformation that you're talking about, which is what we refer to as macroevolutionary change. Now, as we discussed earlier in the show today, nobody's really recognized or nobody really has been alive long enough to see macroevolution of the scale in which we're talking about an ape ancestor turning into a human. But what we do have, and again, I'm coming back to it because we have it over evidence over my head and what we've been talking about throughout the show this afternoon, is that the fossil evidence, the fossil record, provides what I consider to be the best evidence for macroevolutionary change in Earth's history. And
it,
so
it is through mutation, though, right?
Well, mutation is just one mechanism, and it's also recombination as well as the other ways of recombining existing genetic information that also leads to new combinations and in fact can lead to new species. In addition, development is another very, very hot idea and topic today in evolutionary biology. And so even changes in development of organisms, in the growth and development, can change evolutionary trajectories within species. So there's a lot of other ways that change can come about with existing combinations, with existing change, or existing genetics, without invoking some sort of macro mutational event.
And don't forget that Dr. Kramer mentioned the mutations provides the raw material, but it's natural selection, the pressure of the environment that actually forms the organism's change over generations as it goes along.
Creates an appearance of trajectory, for instance. Mm-hmm.
Which what you're saying is that determines whether the mutation is an advantage or a disadvantage.
Right, and most evolutionary biologists understand that if any random input into a highly evolved genome is likely not to be good. So most mutations, in fact, probably deleterious. A lot, in fact, perhaps the majority of them are neutral in that they affect the non-coding sections of our genomes or of animals' genomes.
Can you give me an example of any mutation that you know of without using circular reasoning, falling back to evolutionary theory, where a mutation has been an advantage for a species?
Sure, I'll give you one right now. Have you heard of sickle cell anemia?
Yes.
Well, the allele for sickle cell, in and of itself, in definitely in the double dose, is a deadly mutation, right? So you wouldn't think that's a good mutation, right?
Right.
Okay. But in the single dose, if you get it from one parent, in other words, if you're a carrier for the sickle cell allele, you're actually resistant to malaria. And so populations that are resistant to malaria actually have high levels of this sickle cell allele in this population, even though in the double dose it's a deadly one. So right there is an example of how what seemingly deadly gene can actually provide a benefit for in populations in which they're exposed to malaria, and this genetic combination prevents them from getting malaria. It also is not enough for them to die from sickle cell.
I'd like to ask Daniel a question, if I may.
Sure.
Earlier you mentioned something about how mutations took information out. Do you remember saying that?
That's right.
So we have examples of living people around us where some of their children will be taller or shorter than they are. Do you have any idea? Does taking information out make you taller or shorter?
Taking information out?
Yeah. So if mutations are taking information out, does taking information out make you taller or shorter?
I don't know about that.
Well,
what I'm talking about.
But the point of the question is to actually illustrate that taking information out is a poor way to frame the thing. What we have is mutations make a change of information. It's not information coming out or going in. It is a change of information. And whether or not that information is useful to the offspring is dependent upon the environment they find themselves in.
And you're also thinking that all of our DNA is useful. You're thinking that we have a long string of DNA and everything in it is useful for building a human. What percent is actually used in coding for a human?
Coding DNA
50%,
is even less.
Even less than 50%. There's a lot of junk in there. There's a lot of, matter of fact, we can prove evolution through all the junk, tracking the junk that's in there. But
let me clarify what I meant by taking information out.
What I'm saying is,
let Daniel clarify. We got 5 minutes or so.
I knew where he was going, but go ahead.
Is that you mentioned domesticated animals, domesticated dogs? That basically, from what I understand, is you have a certain amount of information in DNA, and by mixing certain traits, you can breed out certain genetic information. So it's left out, but you're not creating anything new.
You can breed it in and make it stronger.
But can you tell me, does making a greyhound, is that taking information out? How can you say that it's information out to make a greyhound out of a wolf? Isn't it merely different information?
No, it's just you can still take a wolf. From right now, here's what I'm saying. You can take a wolf and you can get a domesticated dog, but you cannot take just domesticated dogs and get a wolf without mutation.
I believe
How do you
that
know
if,
that?
Well,
I mean, he's making assertions without any backup facts.
Well, Daniel, I believe that the example of dogs that go feral is that they tend to breed back towards something that looks more like the wild type, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Daniel, have you watched the program previously?
I did one other time. Yeah, I enjoy your program.
Well, thank you for calling in. We've got about 5 minutes left. We'd like to thank you and free the line up in case we can maybe get another call or two. And we hope that we tried to answer your question honestly. Please consider the implications of what we said about it not being information going in or out, but changing.
Right.
All right? Thanks.
All right. I appreciate it. Thanks.
So before we move on to the maybe the final slides, or maybe we won't get there at all, were we going to be able to talk about atheism and agnosticism?
All right. Well, I introduced myself as Faithless Forest. I call myself an atheist. Larry?
I'm an agnostic atheist.
I don't bother to use that agnostic word for reasons of my own.
The reason I used it is Dr. Kramer brought it in. Agnosticism has to do with whether you know if there's a God or not. Okay. I don't know that there's a God or not, okay, but I don't believe in one, and that has to do with theism. I don't believe in God, so I'm an atheist. So I'm an agnostic atheist. I don't know if there's a God, but I don't believe in one.
And we've talked over our guest. How are you going to answer that question, or questions? Because there's really two questions.
All right, well, I'm not an atheist. And to me, what that means is that I believe there is no God.
Mm-hmm. No, okay. That's without belief.
So Larry has a standard way of asking that question. Ask it the standard way.
I don't remember which way you're referring.
I think you make it very positive. You say, do you believe in a God? If the answer
is anything but yes.
Is anything but yes.
You're an atheist because you're without belief in a God.
Okay.
Now, there's a positive and a negative atheist, or a positive and neutral atheist. A positive atheist or a hard atheist who come out and say, there's no God. I'm not one of those, and I don't know very many of them. Yeah. Most of them say, I don't know, but I don't believe in one.
Okay. Well, can I just...
We got a caller?
We have
a
caller.
Quick.
All right. Well, I just wanted to explain my position as well, because I think it also contextualizes.
Since you're on the air, we better let you answer that question.
I appreciate that. So my perception is that an atheist is somebody that does not believe in God, and a theist is somebody that does.
Mm-hmm.
I'm an agnostic, which means I don't know. And the way that I share how I have what this personal philosophy means for me is for example, a colleague of mine has a bumper sticker that says, militant agnostic. And underneath it, it says, I don't know, and neither do you.
Neither
exactly.
Do you.
Yeah. Now, if I were to make my own, I would write apathetic agnostic, because I don't know, and I don't care.
All right.
And the reason about this, and let me just try to finish this quickly,
yeah,
is that I do have faith, but I don't have faith in any supernatural entities. What I have faith in is in the love of my family,
mm-hmm,
and the goodness of people.
Sure.
So those are the kinds of things that I can take faith in. That's the kinds of things that derive meaning in my life. So I just wanted to share that with the viewers.
I share your faith.
All right.
I do.
Do we want to try and take a call in one minute?
We've got 1 minute. We'll try it.
Hello, caller. We've got just a minute. Give us a name quick and a quick question, and
we'll try to answer.
All right. Thank you very much. I'm a first-time listener. I actually have a question. My name is Brian, and I watched a documentary on dinosaurs, actually, just the other day. Now, they found a T-Rex femur recently. When they cut open the T-Rex femur, they found a sponge-like tissue. Now, this is all over CNN and everything. And when they put the tissue under a microscope, they found identifiable blood cells.
You're familiar with what he's talking about?
I've heard about this. All right. Hey, Brian, thanks. We're going to try and answer you, and we're going to say bye for now.
Thanks.
All right. 30 seconds.
I think what we've heard is that there are some relatively unique preservational situations in which soft tissue can be preserved for millions of years. And I think this is just an example of that.
And it's something like marrow or some connective tissue. It's badly degraded, but it was deep inside a fossil.
Correct.
All right. Well, thank you for being on our show with us today. Larry, let's start working on the closing here.
Okay.
It's time to wrap things up. Get out your pen and paper.
This has been Freethought Forum, a program by the Atheist Society of Knoxville and the Rationalists of East Tennessee.
Please, I jumped on you. I stepped on you. Please send us feedback. You can leave voicemail at 865-272-9060 or email us at freethoughtforum@yahoo.com.
And you can see this show on Tuesdays from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time in this Knoxville station, or at 2200 Universal Time at ctvknox.org, live streaming.
We would like to thank Sam and Jonas for technical support, and the staff at CTV KNOX, and of course to all of our callers.
and to Dr. Andrew Kramer.
And our guest, yes.
And be sure to join us again next week to learn about Satan and hell.